Amen. Amen. And welcome. Welcome to church this morning. Welcome you who are here. Welcome. I know there's more folks on the way. Cindy, would you do me a favor and open the second door too, so that both doors are open and everybody who wants to come in is welcome. Let us continue together in prayer. I invite you just to close your eyes and to allow your body to rest. Rest on the earth. Creator God, thank you so much for your love, your blessing, your peace, your protection. God, thank you that you are with us. We ask that anything that is not of you would be removed from us, God, that we would be fully yours, that we would be remade in your image through this service today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And now I want to invite you to greet one another with a sign of peace, just with a handshake or a hug, welcoming one another this morning. Welcome. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Welcome, welcome, Valentina. Come on in, you guys. Come on in. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. And welcome back from Germany. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Oh, God bless you. Welcome.
Good morning, beautiful.
Thank you so much. God bless you. Peace be with you. Amen. Amen. Let us continue together in praise. I invite you to stand up, and we're going to do, some of you might recognize this folk song that we're going to do with the words to Amazing Grace.
Was lost, but now I am found. What's life?
Amen. Amen. Now, you know what I'd like you to do? If you would read, let's read this scripture together. It's 2 Corinthians 9:8. It's right there in your worship bulletin. Let's read it together. And why don't you, we're going to read it, and then we're going to tell it to one of your neighbors. So let's read it out loud together, and then we're going to tell it to your neighbor. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Okay, now pick a neighbor, tell your neighbor. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, times, having all that you need, you will be able to abound in every good work. Amen. Amen. I want to invite Joseph up, and we're going to sing Trading My Sorrows. Tell your neighbor.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
Tell your other neighbor. Tell your other neighbor. You're not walking out with this stuff.
I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
the creator of everything. Just put your hands on yourself and just say, Lord, you made me. And I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. And now turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, God made you. And you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Unless you're a child, we've got a couple of kids here today. Come on up. Come on up. Welcome. Let's scoot this back so we can all sit up here. Yay, welcome. Nice to see you all. Nice to see you here. You know what? I'm going to come out here where y'all can see me and I can see you. So what are some things that we do? Like when you're, what's a hard time? Anybody have a hard time with anything? What can be a hard time? Joseph, will you pass me the microphone from up there? Just so if anybody wants to answer. Go ahead, Stella. What's a hard time that we could go through?
When you're hurt?
Yeah, when you're hurt, right? Absolutely. What else? What's another hard time we can go through? Anybody? When you're hurt, anybody ever feel lonely sometimes, right? I know I do sometimes, especially, I don't know how many of you were starting a new school. How many of you were in a new school this year? Brand new school. I know Joseph is. He's in a brand new school. He's starting ninth grade. He's in high school. So when you're starting a new school, whether you're starting kindergarten or first grade, even preschool or middle school, high school, you know, it can be like, I don't know anybody. So that can be something, just feeling like a little bit lonely. What else? Any other hard times that you can go through? Anybody else? Who's ever been afraid? Anybody? Anybody here? Right? Yeah, so sometimes we're scared. What's something that you get scared of? Anybody want to share? What? Oh, go ahead, Stella. Thanks for being bold.
When I was about to go on a big roller coaster.
Yes, right? I get scared. I get scared of heights, too. My kids don't get scared of heights, but I do, and I'm like, yes, so right, sometimes it's just something that is exciting, but it's also scary, right? So whatever you're going through, you can trust God. You can lean on God right in that moment. And I know I do, even at the top of a roller coaster, I'm like, God, help me, you know, God, protect me. Even when you're in a new circumstance, you can be like, just God, be with me so I don't feel so lonely. When I'm hurt, God, help me heal. So whatever you're doing, you can always pray for God to be with you, to help you. And that's what God wants to do. God wants to be close to you. So let's say a word of prayer, okay? So just repeat after me, and you all are welcome to repeat after me as well. Dear God, Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, thank you that you are always available to help me when I need it. Remind me to pray, even when things are difficult, and to trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, see you guys after Coast Club. We have an opportunity every time we gather to take action to bless God. You've already taken action to bless God just by coming to church, because God calls us to be in community, to be faithful, to be in fellowship with one another. This is how we grow. We grow by learning to love people who are difficult to love. Has anybody in this room ever been difficult to love? Have you ever done anything that makes it kind of hard for you to be loved in that moment, right? A few of us, just a few. I'm glad there's a few people here that have never been difficult to love. But that does happen. But this is what God's grace enables us to do, is to learn to love each other. And we're called into community to have a place to do that together. And we're also called to invest in that community, in God's community, to help make it happen, to help give the community everything that we need to be a community together. Lights, heat, a place, a beautiful landscape, a place to gather, music, everything that happens through your tithes and offerings. So we have an opportunity right now to give of our tithes and offerings to bless God, to invest in this community. And I want to encourage you to just give whatever you can give with a cheerful heart, because God loves a cheerful giver. So whatever you can give and just be like, yes, that I feel I am blessing God, I'm loving God as I do this, and I'm investing in God's house. So if I could ask a couple of you, maybe Skip and Anna, if you're willing to pass the offering baskets for those who are here. And if you're joining us online, you're also welcome to give. I again, it doesn't say, you know, God loves a giver who gives out of obligation. No, God loves a cheerful giver, so we want to give what we can give with cheerful hearts and to bless God. And as we do that, we'll join together in singing Your Grace and Mercy.
Your grace and mercy brought me living this moment because of You. I want to thank You and praise You too. Your grace and mercy brought me through.
Let's join in singing together.
Your grace and
continue together in prayer. Creator God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts draw us more fully into love with You and one another. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 So a priest buys a lawnmower at a yard sale, and he takes it back home, and he's got, you know, there's grass around the parsonage, and he goes out to mow the lawn, and he pulls on the rope. It's kind of, you know, one of those old school lawnmowers, and nothing happens. Again, nothing happens, and he's getting frustrated, and he tries it again, and it still won't work. So he goes back over to the guy who sold it to him, and he says, I can't get this lawnmower that I got from you to start. And the guy says, that's because you have to curse to get it started. You got to use profanity with this one. And the priest's like, I'm a man of the cloth. I'm a priest, and I'm just not going to, you know, I don't even remember how to swear. I haven't sworn for so long. And the man says, just keep pulling that rope. It'll come back to you. What do we do when we're frustrated? When things are hard? When things don't make sense? When they're difficult? When they're not fair? When we're stuck in circumstances that may even seem impossible? Today's message is trust in God's grace. Trust in God's grace. So last week we were looking at this thing of grace, that everything we receive from God comes by grace through faith. Faith is like my hands going, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, right? That's faith, is I open my hands. You know, it's like if you want to give somebody a present and they're like this, you're gonna just have to put it down in front of them. But if they go like this, they can receive it, right? So faith is that what enables us to receive what God is putting in front of us. God has so many blessings God wants to give us, and it's by faith that we receive them, that we take them in. And grace, so last week we were talking about by grace through faith. This is how everything that God wants to give us comes to us. Even if we have a tiny, tiny little bit of faith, right? A mustard seed of faith. You don't have to have great faith. There are some people who had great faith, and then there's others that just had a tiny little bit. And we can ask God for help with our faith, like the father whose son was sick that said, when Jesus said, do you believe I can do this? And he said, yes, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. You know, he's like, there's a part of me that has faith and there's a part of me that doesn't. But God can help us so that even that tiny bit of faith that we have becomes an avenue. And then as we receive from God, we get stronger. Our faith gets stronger. We build on our experience, and then we've got a testimony, then we've got things we can remember. And sometimes also we can build our faith by remembering things that didn't even happen to us, but they happened to other people of faith. God says this all the way through the scripture. Remember, even the people generations after they came out of Egypt, God says, remember the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. So we can take hold of those faith stories of people who have trusted and then have received miracles, healings have happened, transformation, doors have opened, they've come through circumstances that seem impossible. We can take hold of what happened to others and go, that testifies to who God is, so that's the God that I'm going to believe in. That is one of the strengths of the scripture. It's full of stories that we can go, okay, this is what God has done. God can do it again. So today we're going to be looking at the story of Joseph, and we're going to look at a few passages. It's a wonderful story. It's in Genesis 37. So I want to invite you, if you have a Bible, you're welcome to open it. Otherwise, you'll hear it. I did also in the newsletter, in the e-news, I sent out some film versions of this story, which are fun. I don't know if anybody had a chance to watch them. I also made an error, so forgive me, because I put in, instead of putting the animated version King of Dreams, which is the story of Joseph, I put Prince of Egypt, which is the story of Moses. So that was just my oversight. But Prince of Egypt is an animated film by the same folks who did The King of Dreams, which is what Joseph was known as in that movie that's referring to Joseph. Okay, so it starts. So this story starts in chapter 37. It's in chapter 35 that we learn that Jacob had 12 sons. He had 12 sons. He had two wives. Some of you might remember the story of Leah and Rachel. Jacob actually deceived his brother out of his birthright, had to flee, went to another country, which is the country where his mother was from, and found the woman that he was going to marry, and her father said, work for me for 7 years, and then you'll have her. So he does. He works for Laban, who is Rachel's dad, for 7 years. Any dads in here would like that, right? Get your son-in-law to work for you. I see some dads in here. But get your son-in-law to work for you for 7 years. So he does this with, and Jacob does it. He's like, all right, no problem. Then on the wedding night, the father gives him Leah instead of Rachel and is like, you know what? We have a tradition. The older girl needs to get married first. So that's it. You're marrying Leah. And he's like, okay. So he marries Leah. And then Laban is like, I want 7 more years of work out of you. So he has to work for 7 more years to get Rachel. And then as soon as he does, so now he's got 2 wives. He's got Leah and Rachel. Rachel was the one that he loved and wanted to marry initially. They're both his wives. And they also have servants. And some of his sons were children of their servants. So he has 12 sons in all, and 2 of them were born to Rachel, Jacob's beloved. And so they got special treatment. And Joseph was one of these 2. So let's look at this story, chapter 37, starting in verse 1. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah. So those are the two of his wives' servants. And he brought their father a bad report about them. So he's out tending the sheep with them, and he comes back. He's like, they're not doing it right. Okay, there's Joseph. Now, Israel, this is another name for his father, Jacob, loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he had been born to him in his old age. He didn't even think Rachel was going to be able to conceive and bear a child, but then she was. And so Jacob, also known as Israel, loved him so much. He had been just such a blessing, a surprise blessing. And he made a richly ornamented robe for him. So Joseph has 11 other brothers, and the dad makes a fancy robe just for one of them. How many of you know what happens when you treat one of your kids different than the others, right? I know, like, even if we go out to, you know, I go out to donuts with one son, I got to bring back donuts for the other. Otherwise, it's like, that's not fair, you know, right? Kids are very aware of what is fair and what isn't. And so here's Joseph getting unfair treatment in a positive way for him, but negative for the rest of his brothers. So his dad makes him this richly ornamented robe. This was also a sign that he wasn't going to put Joseph out to work with the sheep anymore. This is not the kind of robe that a shepherd wears. This is a robe that a learned man wears, somebody who's educated and works, you know, a nice job in the cool shade instead of out in the dirty, dusty, hot sun. When his brothers saw that their father loved Joseph more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Now Joseph had a dream, and when he told his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. Okay, so he already is his dad's favorite. He already gets special treatment. He got a special outfit. And now he's like, all of you were bowing down to me in my dream. What would you call somebody like this, right? What do we call Joseph here? Arrogant, right? Kind of an arrogant tattletale, not the nicest person to have in your family. And his brothers say, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? And they hated him even more because of his dream and what he had said. Then Joseph had another dream. Okay, so do you think he might have learned that? Now, do you go tell the dream to your brothers who already hate you? Not the smartest, but that's exactly what he does. He's like, guess what? I had another dream, and this time, here's what happened. The sun and the moon and 11 stars were all bowing down to me. When he told his father, as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down the ground to the ground before you?" So Joseph is not a lovely person. He's got some issues. He's trying to like one up on his brothers. He's tattletaling when they don't do the right thing. He's not the most socially adept, right? He's telling them things that are obviously gonna incite them, you know? And it's funny, he's the youngest brother until Benjamin is born. And I don't know if any of you've seen this, but I have seen this, that sometimes the younger child likes to kind of like, you know, because the older kids already have their niche, and then the younger one wants to figure out like, So he might have kind of been like prodding. He's obviously doing something that is going to incite their anger. But he could just say, well, it wasn't me. It was just a dream I had. So I just told them my dream. I didn't say anything mean to them. So there's Joseph for you. So sometimes we have things to learn. We may have qualities of character, ways of being, habits, ignorant ways of approaching situations, not being thoughtful, not being considerate. And we have some things to learn. And even when we have things to learn, we can trust in God's grace. Even when we fall short, even when we are flawed, all of us our works in progress. You have things, you have rough edges that God wants to smooth out. You have crushed places that God wants to build up. You have blinders on that God wants to take off. Even when you need to grow, you can trust in God's grace. God doesn't leave Joseph arrogant, ignorant. God's grace is coming for Joseph. And perhaps, especially when you have things to learn, you need to trust in God's grace. So then what happens? Let's look at as the story goes on. We're in verse 12. Now his brothers had gone to graze their father's flocks near Shechem, and Israel, his father, said to Joseph, "As you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I'm going to send you to them." And Joseph said, "All right, here I am." He doesn't argue with his dad, even though, you know, his dad has kind of set him up to be in the house. He's obedient. He's not rebellious. He has some good qualities. He just says, "Yes, Father, very well." And he goes out to find them. The story goes on. He doesn't find them right where his father said they would be. But there's a man there that says, actually, they moved on to this other place. So Joseph goes over there. So he perseveres. You know, I don't know if you've ever told your kids or if anybody's ever asked you to do something and you try to do it and it doesn't work out. And you're like, well, I couldn't do it. Sorry. He doesn't do that. He could have, but instead he perseveres. He tries to figure out how to fulfill what his father asked him to do, even though it took an extra step. So he asks where they are. He goes to where this other man who's wandering around tells him where to go. And so then in verse 17, Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. But they saw him in the distance, and he's actually wearing his fancy garb. He didn't come out to help take care of the sheep. He wore his fancy robe. So they see him in the distance with his brightly colored robe shining. And before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. Here comes that dreamer, they said to each other. Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams. When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. Let's not take his life, he said. Don't shed any blood. Throw him into this cistern here in the desert, but don't lay a hand on him. Reuben said this. He was going to come back and rescue Joseph later and take him back to his father. But then Reuben leaves, and when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the richly ornamented robe he was wearing. And they took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. And then the brothers sat down to eat their lunch. And they looked up and they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm, and myrrh. And they went on their way to take them down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, what will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother. He's our own flesh and blood. His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 pieces of silver to the Ishmaelites who took him to Egypt. Sometimes we are mistreated. There are things that happen. You might have made a mistake, but it doesn't mean you deserve to be crucified. You might have done something wrong. You've got some things to learn, but it doesn't mean you should be humiliated. It doesn't mean you should be abandoned. And yet this is what happens to Joseph. He is sold into slavery. His beautiful coat is taken and torn up. Even when he is being mistreated, God's grace is still at work. You can trust in God's grace even when you're being mistreated, and perhaps that's the time that we most need to trust in God's grace. How can you get through something that is unfair, that is wrong, that is hurtful, that you don't like, that you wish wasn't happening? That's when you need to trust in God's grace, to lean on God. Joseph got sold into slavery. And yet he continued to trust in God. There's a Turkish theologian, Ziya Meral, who writes, where is God when millions of his children are being persecuted in the most brutal ways? We are blessed here. We get to come to worship. We get to worship God, and we're not persecuted. It's not like that in Turkey. It's not like that in other places in the world. And this Turkish theologian says, why does God keep silent in the midst of persecution, but seem to speak loudly in the middle of conferences with famous speakers and worship bands? I have prayed many times like Luther, says morale. Bless us, Lord. Even curse us, but don't keep silent. Morale goes on to say, the greatest glory Jesus brought God was not when he walked on water or prayed for long hours, but when he cried out in agony in the Garden of Gethsemane and still continued to follow God's will, even though it meant isolation, darkness, and the silence of God. When everything around us fails, when we are destroyed and abandoned, our tears are the greatest worship songs we have ever sung. Even in hard times, you can trust God. You can trust God. You can give him your tears. So then what happens? So Joseph goes on down to Egypt, beginning of chapter 39. Potiphar, an Egyptian who was one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there. I love this song. There's so many good songs in Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, right? Potiphar had very few cares. He was one of Egypt's millionaires. He had made a fortune buying shares in pyramids. And he didn't have to worry about a thing. In fact, he had all the wealth, all the money that he wanted. He bought Joseph as a servant. And the scripture says in 39:2, the Lord was with Joseph. The Lord was with Joseph. Here is a man who has been mistreated by his family, sold into slavery, now is working as a slave for the captain of the Egyptian guard far away from home. God is with him. There is no place you can go that God's grace cannot reach you, that God's love cannot be with you, that God's help cannot give you support. The Lord was with Joseph, and he prospered. We've been looking at this, and I put it on in your notes from last week. Prosperity. Prosperity, according to the Bible, is not a Cadillac and a mansion. Prosperity is having what you need to do what God has called you to do, and enough left over to help others fulfill their divine destiny as well. That is biblical prosperity. So here's Joseph. He is a slave in this Egyptian officer's house. God is with him and he prospered. He lived in the house of the Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything he owned. I love this verse. From the time he put Joseph in charge of his household and of all that he owned, the Lord blessed the house of the Egyptian because of Joseph. And the blessing of the Lord was on Potiphar and everything he had in his house and in his field, so that he left everything in Joseph's care. And with Joseph in charge, Potiphar did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Joseph handled everything else. Now, Joseph was well built and handsome, and the story goes on to say how Potiphar's wife desired him and kept on coming after him and saying, come and sleep with me. And Joseph said, no, I can't do that to my master, and I can't do that before God. I won't. And one day, nobody was in the house, and she grabbed him, and she grabbed his cloak, and it tore off of him, and he ran out, and she screamed and said that he had tried to violate her. But when she screamed, he had run away. So Potiphar comes down furious and throws Joseph in jail. Joseph is now in jail. And look what happens in verse 20. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. But while Joseph was there in the prison, the Lord was with him and showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So he is in circumstances that he doesn't like, that he doesn't want, that aren't fair, that aren't right, and yet God is with him. God gives him favor. God doesn't leave him abandoned. Sometimes you might think, if I'm in this circumstance, it's because God is mad at me, God hates me, God has abandoned me, God has left me all my own. Why am I dealing with this? No. God is with you. Are you with God? Joseph stayed with God. Joseph kept trusting in God's grace. Joseph kept leaning on God, and God was with him. God was with him because Joseph had his hands like this, and he received God. He had faith to trust God. He kept on looking to God as his source, as his strength, as his identity. He didn't form his identity as a prisoner, as a slave, even as a mistreated family member. He didn't become resentful. He could have. He could have been there in jail. He could have been in Potiphar's house and just been like, I'm not serving you. I don't owe you anything. How many times we go through difficult circumstances and we get resentful and angry and self-righteous? When we do that, we are literally saying no to God, because God says forgive. We have to forgive our enemies. We have to forgive and pray for those who mistreat us. As we are obedient, we are faithful. If I'm not obedient, I'm not faithful. Either I believe God is God, and God says forgive, and God says love, and God says be a blessing wherever you are, and I'm going to be faithful to God, or not. Faith and obedience go hand in hand. And so here is Joseph. Instead of getting resentful and self-righteous and rebellious, he humbles himself. He looks to God. He knows his identity is in God. Your identity is not as a victim. Your identity is not as someone who's been abused. Your identity is not as someone who is stuck in circumstances. That is not who you are. Joseph keeps on knowing that he is a child of God. He keeps trusting God. And in the middle of difficulty, God is with him. He trusts in God's grace. In chapter 39, verse 22, it says, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in the prison. And he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. So Joseph was able to show the prisoners mercy, to treat the prisoners right, knowing that he had been there unfairly. Joseph was able to show God's love in that circumstance. Even when you are stuck in circumstances you don't like or you don't want, you can trust in God's grace, and perhaps especially when you are in circumstances you don't like or you don't want. Trust in God's grace. God moved in grace. Joseph had some things to learn, and as we see, as we'll pick up here and go into the rest of this story, Joseph had things to learn, and all of his circumstances were refining him. Don't get angry at the devil. Somebody said the devil is just the sandpaper God uses to smooth you out. I love this quote, and I want to end with this by Alan Redpath, who was a theologian, a preacher, an author, a couple of decades back. He says, "There is nothing, no circumstance, no trouble, no testing that can ever touch me until, first of all, it has gone past God, past Christ, right through to me. If it has come that far, it has come with a great purpose, which I may not understand at the moment. But as I refuse to become panicky, as I lift up my eyes and accept it as coming from the throne of God for some great purpose of blessing to my own heart, no sorrow will ever disturb me. No trial will ever disarm me. No circumstance will cause me to fret, for I shall rest in the joy of the Lord." Even in the midst of horrible or difficult or uncomfortable or impossible circumstances, trust in God's grace. Will you do that? Amen. Amen. Let us continue together in prayer. Creator God, Lord Jesus Christ, so often when we are in difficult circumstances, we fall into resentment, complaining, rebelling, self-righteousness, anger, self-justification, self-protection. God, please forgive us. Forgive us by your grace, your precious blood, your holy love, your grace that is based not on our doing right or being perfect or always faithful or obedient. Sometimes all we have is a tiny grain of faith, God, and we ask that you would let that be enough, that your grace would abound to us, that it would transform us even in difficult circumstances, that we would trust in your grace, that we would lay down our sorrow and pick up joy, that we would lay down our self-righteousness and pick up humility, that we would lay down our anger and pick up love, that we would lay down our fear and pick up faith and trust, that our hands would be open to receive that which you want to give us. As we join together in the prayer that you taught us, saying together, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory now and forever. Amen." Every time we gather here at this church, we have an opportunity to feast on the love of God. on the night that Jesus gathered with his disciples, even knowing that a number of them would betray him, that he would be crucified, and needing to trust God in the midst of that pain, he took the bread and, giving thanks to God, he blessed it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. As often as you eat, remember me." And then at the end of the meal, he took the cup. And we remember the blood and water that flowed from Jesus' side. And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you eat, as often as you drink, remember me." The feast of God for the people of God, all who seek and desire to be free in God's love are welcome at this table. Come forward, kneel. You can receive the bread, dip it in the cup. There's wine in this cup and grape juice in the other. And receive, partake. Anna, will you come and serve with me? Thank you so much. allowing yourself to receive all the blessings of God. The Lord Jesus Christ came for sozo, that we might be saved, that we might be healed, that we might be delivered. God, we thank you that you desire our complete freedom so that we would be free to love without constraint, without restraint, to love you, to love one another as you have loved us, with all of who you are. May we live in you, with you, for you, through you, as ambassadors for you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So a couple of things, just announcements. You'll see we always have Bible study on Tuesdays. We have a noontime Bible study. We have Bible study right now on Thursday mornings for men, a men's Bible study on the Gospel of John. We've scheduled the Women in Prayer, which is going to be Tuesday mornings. The fall kickoff is going to be happening in 2 weeks. So if you can come, it's going to be a wonderful time. There's going to be just like muffins and fruit and things like that at 10 o'clock, and then prayer at 10:30 to restart the women's prayer group. Also, next Sunday, we're going to be taking a little welcome video. School just started 3 days ago, or on Wednesday, and for some people, I know some folks, it's starting coming up in the coming week. Next Sunday, we're going to take a video of the kids, and you might inadvertently be in the video. If you, for any reason, don't want to be, please let me know. Otherwise, mostly it's going to be the kids. If you've got kids, let me know. We'll make sure to get a release form from everybody, and it'll be a little video that we can just say, welcome, bring your kids, school's starting, we hope you'll come. So we have a wonderful filmmaker in our midst who is going to be doing that. So that is a blessing, one of the moms. And just one other thing. We're going to be having small groups starting up. If you'd like, if there's a particular topic or group or role that you'd like to play in a small group, please do let me know. And because we're going to be putting those together in the next couple of weeks. If you would like to help with hospitality to welcome guests on Sunday, or if you'd like to be a reader, you can also let me know, and we will be grateful for your help to welcome everyone. If you're here for the first time, welcome, and please do make sure that we give you a mug. We want to welcome you and be able to get your information if you'd like to share it. We don't sell it to anyone, of course. It just goes on you would get our e-news. So that you know what's happening. And now, in the name of the Creator of all life, of the Holy Lord Jesus Christ, God with us, Emmanuel, and of the Holy Spirit, go forth in peace, in love, knowing who you are, and knowing that you can trust in God's grace. Amen. Amen. Amen.